Women are the fastest growing segment of the veteran population, but women veterans face many of the same health and mental health problems as their male counterparts. So how is the VA changing to meet the needs of women veterans? We'll have answers next on Healing America's Heroes, Women Veterans Health.
Thank you to the Eunice Joyce Gardner Charitable Foundation for its leadership support of the Health Channel.
Welcome to our town hall, Healing America's Heroes, Women Veterans Health. I'm Olga Villaverde. Did you know women are the fastest growing segment of veterans? They are. There are more than 2 million women veterans, and while they're entitled to the same health benefits as men, less than 50% of women veterans use the VA healthcare system. There are a number of reasons for this, and we're going to get into them in our town hall in just a few moments. But first, we want to hear from the veterans themselves about why it's important to have the right support. Take a look.
Even though that we served as well as men and we want to be looked at equally in the same, we are different. We have different challenges physically and mentally. There's just something different about the level of care that we need. And when I go into the women's clinic, I'm there because I'm a woman veteran and they treat me as such. So to walk in somewhere where you feel comfortable with other people who have similar experiences just because they are women, it takes a lot of that anxiety and anxiousness away.
So I ended up getting another female doctor, and it took a little while, but I finally opened up to her and somebody could hear me for once, and I could just let go. And I went in there and I just screamed and yelled and cried, and I didn't even know what half of what I said was or why I said it. I just got it out, and she let me cry. This was a release and there was no judgment, and she wasn't trying to fix me, she was just listening to me.
You have to be more responsible for your own care. And then try again.
With therapy, I was able to not only find my true self, but also find my true happiness. Now I'm a good mom, and I'm a good wife, and I'm a good friend.
Before we introduce our panel, I'd like to introduce my co-host, Dr. Michael Zinner. He's the CEO and Executive Medical Director of the Miami Cancer Institute. As always, great to have you here, Dr. Zinner.
Thank you, Olga. This is a very important topic. I'm a former veteran, and I've worked in the VA as a civilian physician, and I've seen the need for improved women's health care.
Now, let's introduce our panel. Joining us today is Dr. Monina Mabuti. She is the Women's Health Medical Director at the West Palm Beach VA Healthcare System. Welcome. Also joining us is Melva Rozier, Supervising Attorney of Veterans Advocacy Projects at the Legal Aid Society of Palm Beach County. And finally, Dr. Lori Sutton. She is a retired Brigadier General and was the U.S. Army's highest ranked psychiatrist. I also want to make note that in just a few moments, Montel Williams will also be joining us. Again, that'll be in about 5 to 10 minutes. But for now, I'd like to welcome all of you. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks for being here. So Dr. Zinner, I want to start with a recent addition by the VA that could make a big difference to some women veterans who might be at risk for breast cancer.
Yes, breast cancer is already the second leading cause of cancer deaths among women. And while there is no link between breast cancer and burn pits, there's enough concern that the VA is working to help women veterans through the Service Act.
Absolutely. So let's take a look at this graphic. It's really important. The Act expands breast cancer risk assessments and mammograms to women veterans who have experienced toxic exposure in certain combat areas. The Act also includes transgender women who have been on hormone therapy for more than 5 years and some transgender men. So Dr. Mabuti, let me start with you. Can you explain what the Service Act does? And while you're answering that question, we're going to be showing the combat areas of exposure that are covered under the Service Act as of now.
Thank you so much. So I really want to thank everyone for this opportunity to talk about women's health. The Service Act expands clinically appropriate mammograms for veterans who were in specific combat areas during specific time frames, as you mentioned. And it was named after Dr. Kate Hendricks Thomas, who was a U.S. Marine veteran, and she was deployed in Iraq in 2005. And while she was there, she was exposed to a burn pit for many years. And at the age of 38, she was diagnosed with metastatic breast cancer. And unfortunately, she passed away at the age of 42. So there is no evidence or link between breast cancer and burn pits, but the VA is being proactive about this, and they would like to encourage all veterans who served in those combat areas during those specific time frames to talk to their provider about a breast cancer risk assessment. And if they don't have a provider, we encourage them to enroll in the VA and get a breast cancer risk assessment done.
Melba, how is this different from the PACT Act that also deals with toxic exposure?
So with the PACT Act is really designed to help veterans get compensation based on where they served, and it's more expansive, whereas the Service Act is limited to access to care and being preventative about cancer based on where you were located as a veteran.
So, Dr. Sutton, we know that the VA is working with the Department of Defense to widen the combat areas and frame the toxic exposure under the Service Act. How far back do you think they need to go?
You know, that's a great question, and it's an easy one, I think, at least for me to answer. It needs to go back as far as any veteran who is alive today who has been exposed to toxic exposures, whether it was, for example, my own experience in the first Gulf War, when we were stranded, really covering the borderline between Iraq and Kuwait. We were right by the oil wells, 10 o'clock in the morning. We had to have a flashlight to look like this. And we called it then Agent Oil, as we had black gunk coming out of our noses and our mouths during that time. But go back to whatever time a woman or male veteran, any veteran, was exposed and is still suffering, that veteran needs to be covered.
Thank you so much, Doctor. Melva, if a woman or transgender veteran doesn't qualify under the Service Act and is concerned about their risk of breast cancer, what other options might they have?
There's also the Mammo Act, which I know our good doctor will be speaking about shortly, that also provides some breast cancer screening and mammogram services for people who are transgender.
Yeah, Dr. Mabuti, before we leave the subject, let's also talk about the Mammo Act, the Mammography and Medical Option Act for women veterans. And can you briefly describe what it is and who it's for?
Yes, so the Mammo Act, which stands for Making Advances in Mammography and Medical Options for Veterans Act. Yes, the VA likes its acronyms. And that act focuses on improving breast cancer screening and treatment options for our veterans. And it focuses on those veterans who actually are in the rural areas, those in remote areas, and also women who have disabilities or mobility issues, because it expands mammogram in telehealth, basically mobile mammograms, so that these women can access these important screenings.
Thank you so much, Doctor. Okay, so here are some numbers I'd like to share with our panel and our viewers, of course, about women veterans. Take a look at this. In the year 2000, women made up only 4% of all veterans, but that number is expected to rise to 18% by 2040. That's pretty good increase there, Dr. Sutton. So here's my question. Women veterans' health is a top priority, obviously, for the VA. Are all women veterans eligible for health care benefits at the VA?
That's an important question. First of all, I'd just like to applaud the VA for being proactive, for really, no kidding, since the 80s when the first Federal Advisory Committee was stood up for veterans to the 90s when the Women's Health Center. It's just been an ongoing escalation in support and services. And for me as a woman veteran who I got out of the Army in 2010, I have seen over these last 13 years, it's just been phenomenal. And yes, to that end, your question, women veterans are eligible. All women veterans are eligible for women-related health care needs, whether it be, as you mentioned, breast care, mammograms, PAPs, reproductive health care, as well as you know, the kind of care that may be involved with PTSD, depression, mental health kinds of concerns. I will say this, that the women's health centers are just as the woman veteran in the video said, they are a sanctuary. And there may also be service-related or service-connected conditions for which women veterans are eligible, and they should absolutely go through the process of evaluation and disability determination. But the fact that the VA's now got a women's health call line that you can call and you can actually talk to someone who can guide you and help you navigate, I think it's just a phenomenal journey of success that just keeps getting better and better for women veterans in the VA system.
And Dr. Sutton, I got to say, I love your enthusiasm and your passion, because I can see you're so thrilled with all of this information that we're getting out there. Melva, let me ask you this. Is there anything a woman can do to improve her chances of becoming eligible?
I don't necessarily know if there's a way to improve their chances, but the reality is that by being a woman and being a veteran, you're eligible for care. I think that's the most exciting thing. I'm an Army veteran as well. And that's sufficient. The care is there. I think a lot of females don't understand that it's available, that there's no pre-qualification. You just need to sign up and try again if they tried previously. It's probably the biggest advice that I would provide to female veterans. Try again.
Fantastic. And just like I had said at the beginning of the show, that we do have now Montel Williams. Everyone knows he's a television host, a U.S. Marine and Navy veteran, and of course, a well-known advocate for veterans. Montel, thank you so much for being able to join us here on this town hall.
Thanks so much for having me. I'm so sorry for the weird connections, but I'm glad I'm here.
No worries. Great to have you. Dr. Zinner?
So, Montel, we know you're a big advocate for veterans, and we've been talking about the role that women and women's health play in their own health here at the VA. Do you think they have enough input, and does the VA offer them as much information and health care as they need?
Please forgive me, because I'm not saying anything to be disparaging in any way, shape, or form. But I'm here to tell you that there's a disconnect between the information that's being provided and getting to the recipient who needs to have it. I do a show that's called Military Makeover. We recently did an episode with female veteran who suffered from a traumatic military sexual assault. And she still is bearing the brunt of that today, even though that happened 14 years ago. So as much as we like to think that if we can just put a program together, throw it up on a wall and say it's here, that the recipient's going to receive it, that's not necessarily true. You got to start getting in the trenches and making sure these women know that these services are available to them. You know, you have to get out in the street and advocate for them. I believe that when we look at women veterans, female veterans, I think they are the most underserved, and especially those that are homeless, the most underserved of any of our veterans. So I think that services, like, you know, the last doctor said, there are services out there, but it's not translating into the street. Not translating and reaching the recipient that needs to have it.
Thank you, Montel. Before we get to more questions that we have here for our panel, I actually have a question from a viewer who just wrote, and her name is Melissa, and she's on Facebook. Thank you, Melissa. It's a great question, Dr. Zinner. Why is it just breast cancer? Why not other women's health issues, especially since the time frame for pap smears has shifted to every 5 years? Early detection is key to any cancer. Love that question.
And they're right about early detection being the only way to cure some of the cancers that we take care of.
Let's
toss this to Dr. Mabuti. Let's see what are your thoughts on this?
The VA really does, focus on prevention, because as you mentioned, prevention is key. If we catch cancer early, we have many more treatment options, and the outcome is better. So the VA does focus on prevention. We do have cervical cancer screening at the VA, and we do focus on cervical cancer screening data, and we make sure that our women veterans that come to our clinics, we screen them, and then women who may have, you know, fallen out of the system, we do try to reach out to them so that they can come back and we can screen them as well.
Thank you so much. I have another viewer question. It's from Wendy on Facebook. Thank you, Wendy. She's writing, will the PACT Act take 10 years for payment? Melva, you want to take that for me?
Yes. The PACT Act is much quicker than traditional VA claims have ever been. Mm. The average adjudication right now on those claims are between 6 and 9 months. So it's a very expedited process. There's not a lot of back and forth and qualification. You're qualified because you were there in this particular act. So much faster. If you've tried before, try again. It's a much better process and very streamlined. Thank you.
No, thank you very much. So if you're a woman, a vet, or a family member who has questions about women's health services or resources at the VA, you can call the Women Veterans Call Center. Here's the number. We want to show it to you. It's 855-829-6636. That's 855-829-6636. They're open, as you can see right there, Monday through Friday, 8 a.m. to 10 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, Saturdays, 8 to 6:30.
Now, here's a little bit of history. It's been about 100 years since the National Home for Disabled Volunteer Soldiers, which later became part of what we now know as the Veterans Administration, accepted World War I Army and Navy women nurses for hospitalization and medical care.
But things have changed a lot since then, Dr. Zinner. Let's take a look at one woman vet's experience at the VA today. Take a look.
My name is Sharisa Jackson. I'm a retired Air Force nurse, and I went to Iraq and Afghanistan 3 times, so I did 3 combat deployments. Having been deployed 3 times to Iraq and Afghanistan, I suffer from PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder. And while on active duty, I actually sought after mental health services, and I continued that therapy after I became a veteran, after I retired. It doesn't go away, so I still have triggers, I still have challenges. Being able to stay in that loop and have access to care after active duty has been what's helped me. And I saw that in the VA, and I continue to get that in the VA. I love my women's health clinic. It's a comprehensive approach to my health. If I need my blood work, if I need my mammogram, if I need anything dealing with my mental health, of course, all that is under one roof. So I love that one-stop shop approach. That works for me, and I think it works for a lot of veterans who are in need of those services. I tell women veterans all the time, remember, you are a veteran. Women have to acknowledge that though they may not be deployed or they may not go to combat, they still are veterans when they exit the military, and they need to captivate on those resources available, particularly at the Women's Health Center and any other resources within the VA. Because I want veterans to know that there is hope out there, and the VA is their hope. Don't deny yourself those services. And I advocate for that for women every single day.
Dr. Sutton, there's still criticism about the culture of respect, not only for women, but also for the LGBTQ community. How can the VA combat that?
Boy, I'll tell you, it's a tough one. Let's start with the LGBTQ plus community. So many of us, when we were in uniform, experienced well before the don't ask, don't tell law, which was an improvement over what went on before, which was a time when all too many Americans, not just folks in the military, but viewed homosexuality as a crime or a serious mental disturbance, a character disorder, and felt perfectly justified in the harshest measures and punishments. So fast forward to today, and thankfully, there's been a lot of progress. If you look at what the VA has on its website in terms of LGBTQ plus care, every medical center has a representative who you can go straight to and get guidance in terms of how to access the gay specific care you may need, whether it's transgender care. There's not yet coverage for surgical care as our transgender brothers and sisters may require. But there's all kinds of care for everything up until that point. And I think that's a culture that's in evolution. That was a tough jump to make for the VA. And I was so glad to hear earlier talk about the legal advocacy work, because so many folks went out on bad paper, bad conduct, really horrific injustices that are hard to redress when you feel like, you know, you've suffered in silence or in shame for so many years. So it's a work in progress, and it requires every single one of us to speak up. And if we see something that's a measure or a sign of disrespect, we have to say something. We have to do something. This is our VA, and these are our brothers and our sisters, whether they come from the LGBTQ plus community, women's veterans, any veteran coming through the VA. And by the way, we know that it's less than half for women, but it's even worse when you put in all of the veterans. It's about 1 in 4 actually access their VA healthcare benefits. And we got to change that. While at the same time, we're working with the VA to make those benefits and that outreach and that culture of care even more powerful and compelling.
Thank you, Dr. Sutton. You know, Montel, I love what she said about it's still a work in progress. Would love to hear your thoughts on this as well, if you don't mind.
Again, I do not want to come off as if I'm the guy who's bashing anybody, because I'm not. But I'm going to tell you the truth. We live in a society right now where all of a sudden misogyny seems to be something that's okay. We live in a society where we just found out that a former head at the Coast Guard Academy was literally called to the carpet because he was sexting some of his subordinates. And he left there. They didn't even take his job away. He went there and left and became a president of another university. We live in a society that is, I think, we've taken 3 steps forward. We're taking 5 steps back. And we're allowing this to happen. And I'm disgusted, to be honest with you, by the treatment of our LGBTQ plus shipmates, airmen, Coast Guardsmen. But I'm also disgusted by the fact that we know for a fact one of the largest growing demographics in our military are women. And we do know when they leave the service, somewhere close to 55 to 60% of them have been sexually assaulted or sexually traumatized in some way. Out of the ones that are homeless, we know that between 50 and 60% of them have got that in their history. And that's part of the reason why they have the mental illness and issues that they have. So yes, I think it's on the chalkboard. Yes, I think it's on the blotter and on the desk of some, but they look at it maybe once a week and look away. It's time to start looking at it every day. As a nation that has the nerve, to put women into combat, and let's remember, less than 1% of this entire country puts a uniform on its back to protect its democracy. And out of that less than 1%, 16% of that are women. And if we're gonna take the least of us, demand from them the most of us, to protect all of us, we better step up to the plate and recognize that we've got to give them the services that they need to keep them resilient, to keep them talking to the next generation, asking them to come back. And I don't mean that as a disparaging comment to anybody, but I'm telling you, it's lip service is done. It's time to get busy, get real, get in the trenches, and start helping these veterans who paid so much and given up so much for us.
Montel, I'll tell you, we feel your passion. We understand what you're saying. And it actually leads me to a question for you, Melva. If a woman feels like she's been the victim of harassment at the VA and also feels like nothing's been done to correct it, does she have other options?
Absolutely. If it's happening at the VA, the veteran is feeling that she's being harassed, intimidated, she has the option to report it at the VA. She can speak to a patient advocate or anyone within the clinic she may be visiting. Additionally, if they want to report it anonymously, there's the option to report it to the Office of Inspector General, and it will be investigated, and the veteran will know whatever the outcome is. But there are preventative measures that are available.
But doctor, can I ask a question real quick? I'm so sorry.
Absolutely, Montel.
The question I have is that we have a Senate and a Congress that can pass laws to end this type of discrimination, holding the chain of command responsible. And I mean totally responsible in a way that, you know, you don't just miss a promotion. If you denied
which one?
The treatment for a sailor or soldier or airman, Coast Guardman, woman who or male who was sexually abused, and you deny them, you know, due process. I'm so sorry. It's time for big time for the chain of command. It's time for us to bring this to a halt. There's not enough hammer. You know, I'm saying that we need to have hammer. We need to have something that can literally hold people accountable and make sure they recognize that if you turn your back on one of us that have been treated this way, we're coming after you.
Thanks, Montel. Appreciate your passion as well. I really do. I have a viewer question from Peggy on Facebook. Thank you, Peggy. Dr. Mabuti, I'm going to give this one to you if you don't mind. She writes, will the VA be adding any holistic type doctors for veterans that prefer herbal and holistic medicine? Great question there.
Yeah, so this is a wonderful question. I agree with you. The VA is providing whole health services already at this time. And whole health is near and dear to my heart because, you know, it focuses on the veteran and their health and wellness. And whole health is not your traditional type of medicine. And it does focus on the veteran, as I've mentioned. It does incorporate a lot of the alternative type treatment modalities like yoga and tai chi, aromatherapy, functional nutrition, and incorporating that into the veteran's health and wellness. And so I think that's the VA's way of starting to incorporate some of the holistic type medicine into the system.
Olga, I'd like to share another bit of history about the VA and women veterans. In 1948, the first facilities for women veterans were constructed in two hospitals, one in Massachusetts and one in Washington State.
And today, every VA health system facility has a women's clinic, and they offer a host of health services for women veterans. Here's a list of them, for example. Here are the main ones. Primary care, reproductive care, mental health, cancer and health screenings, immunizations, military exposures, and whole health. Dr. Sutton, let me ask you this. One of those services are, well, many of them are self-explanatory, but I'm looking at the one right there, which is, and I lost it right now, but it's whole health. That's what it was, whole yes. health. Can you tell me a little bit about that one and what it means?
This is a tremendous advance for the VA. It's a cultural transformation. It's been in progress for, I would say, probably the last 8 to 10 years. But as was spoken about just a minute ago, it involves really attention to the veteran as an individual, his or her family, their social support. What are their aspirations? It pays attention to the mind, the brain, the body, the spirit, all of that white space that goes on in our lives between our healthcare appointments. It is a huge, huge step forward for the VA. And I think it's something that as this whole health culture continues to strengthen and to undergird the VA's total whole health approach, the impact will be felt much more broadly beyond the VA. It's what needs to happen all over healthcare is a whole person approach to our most precious attribute, our health, our well-being, our aspirations, our goals. I would say in terms of the specific question, VA has not yet gone far enough, in my view, in terms of really embracing these herbal modalities, for example, that have been around for hundreds and even thousands of years. They've made steps toward, as was mentioned, with some of the martial arts and yoga and tai chi and service dogs even. But I think we need to remind ourselves, as well as our VA system, that these are not ordinary times. We are still in the middle of a suicide epidemic, as one example. And we need to treat this with the kind of urgency that these issues demand. It's not okay to just say business as usual, we'll get to it in another year or 2 or 5 years or the next Congress, the next president. It's now.
Thank you so much, Doctor. Melva, the VA provides maternity care through referrals to local community providers. Can that put a burden on the veteran trying to coordinate different doctors with the VA, especially in underserved communities?
Absolutely. The time to get the referral to a community partner should be 14 days. Realistically, it just took me 60 days to get an eye appointment. So I can't imagine the urgency that a veteran who is pregnant and has to be referred out is experiencing. However, to combat some of the transitional issues, each VA does have a maternity coordinator that is supposed to work with veterans and to help them navigate the community referral process and make it easier and more centralized.
So, thank you so much. Thanks, Melva. We have a question from a viewer, and she says, my friend is a veteran and wants to have a baby. She's not married, but has a donor who will provide the sperm. She says the VA told her, and Dr. Zinner, I'm not sure about this one, but she says the VA told her that she's not eligible for IVF because she's not married.
Wow. Dr. Sutton, can you help us and take that one?
Sure. I've researched this because the question has come up in some of the folks that I've been speaking with in recent months. And, I think it's something that needs to be taken up with the VA to clarify, because when you go to their website that talks about IVF care and reproductive health, in one section it talks about the woman veteran and her partner. In another section, it talks about a woman and her spouse. And I think it would be short-sighted of the VA at this point, understanding as we do about the myriad diverse combinations that form today's family. And women veterans are no less involved in that wave of transformation across our society than anyone else, and they should not be, in my view, barred from seeking the reproductive health care they are looking for based upon an arbitrary spousal requirement. Certainly there has to be a process to understand the social support and family and all of the rest to ensure success. But it's not clear to me from their own website whether it's a partner or whether it's an actual marriage requirement. Needs clarification.
Okay.
And may I add something
Absolutely.
To that as well, if I may? So for this veteran's question, if they would like to have a child and they have donor sperm, then and they are able to receive healthcare services at the VA, they would be qualified to actually receive intrauterine insemination, which is IUI. And that should be effective as well. And they may not need IVF, which is in vitro fertilization. So in vitro fertilization is a special benefit for veterans who are service connected for conditions that cause infertility. But like I said, this particular veteran is a candidate for intrauterine insemination, IUI, which is a benefit that our veterans receive up to 6 cycles.
Okay, thank you, doctor, very
much. That is so helpful to know. Thank you so much for that clarification.
And that's why we're having this amazing town hall. By the way, I want to turn to military sexual trauma, or MST, which includes sexual assault and harassment. Now, what is not only women who are victims, they're the most affected by it. Take a look at this. According to the Department of Defense, over 7,000 service troops, both men and women, said they experienced sexual assault during military service, and 1 in 3 women veterans have told the VA they experienced sexual assault or harassment while in the military. Montel, I'm going to come to you in just a minute, but first I want to show this video. Her name is Michelle, and she talks about her experience that she went through. Take a look.
While I was stationed at Fort Hood, Texas, I was on TDY to Dyess Air Force Base, and I was sexually assaulted by security forces personnel. And it went to trial, and he got off on a technicality. My transition out of the military was not voluntary. It was due to a weight control failure. By that point in time, it had been 2 years since I had actually been officially diagnosed with major depressive disorder. I had been on several different antidepressants, and some of them that I was on actually caused me to gain weight. I've had a lot of great counselors with the VA. It's helped my healing process in a way that having to, one, establish boundaries, which I felt like this is the first time I've done this in my entire life, and to regain my self-confidence. I used to always think that everything was my fault, and I had to learn that it wasn't my fault, Having PTSD and being violated the way I was in the military, you lose a lot of trust. And so I feel that my counselor is maybe at least that one person that I can trust. It's scary to know how many people, both men and women, have been assaulted while serving their country. But you can go to the vet center and you can get enrolled in services. It'll be the best thing that you ever do, and it might be hard, but you have to take the first step, and you need to go, and you just need to ask for the help, and there's no shame in doing that.
Montel, that's such a moving piece and so important. I'd like to hear your reaction.
No, I got to tell you, there are lots of veterans who go to the VA looking for help. Some of them are discouraged when they show up there because the way they're questioned, or sometimes the way they're treated, sometimes that person who looks at them with a look that maybe are you really telling the truth, makes it really tough for them to want to share that story with someone else. You showed a number of 1 in 3. I think Dr. Sutton might agree with me, but that number might be higher than that because there are so many of these sexual assaults that go unreported. They go unreported because the soldier doesn't want to end up being pushed out of the military in some way, shape, or form because the trauma is so real to them, it makes them maybe less proficient at their performance in other areas, where we as the VA and we as the government need to recognize that it traumatizes people. And they've been traumatized in a way that no one else has been traumatized, and we need to get them help. There's a protocol that I and General Sutton have been working with for now years. It's called the RTM protocol. It has now proven to be in the plus 90% efficaciousness in remitting symptoms of sexual trauma. Not only that, but also PTSD. And, you know, this has been an uphill battle now for 12 years with the VA. This is being used now in Poland and the Ukraine to help support military soldiers and civilians who have gone through these kinds of trauma over there. It's being used and right now being double-blind studied with Walter Reed, been double-blind studied at King's College. This thing has proven in every step along the way to be successful for 9 out of every 10 people who go through the protocol. And it's time for us to embrace new modalities and not get stuck in the past of having to retread something that we thought would work but was only 35% of the cases, shift over to something that we know works. And so, you know, to be able to do that and offer these female veterans an opportunity where they are not shamed. I mean, we hear about it all the time in the civilian world where a person has a sexual assault and they go to a judge or they go to the police and the police shame them into going back home, embarrassed that they ever brought it up. We still do that. Let's not think we don't do that in the military. We do that. And that's what I said earlier about the fact that we need to put some teeth. We need a Congress and a Senate that's willing to put some teeth behind making sure that those who are the perpetrators go to jail. The fact that a guy got off in that case that you just showed left us now thinking that it didn't happen. It happened. So let's start making sure that there's teeth. And until we do that, this is going to continue. We live in a society that's allowing women, not so long, by law, made it it's a woman's right to serve her country if she chooses to. If we're going to do that for her, we give her all the backing she needs to do that successfully.
Montel, a critically important message. Really appreciate your passion again on a very important subject. Let me turn to Melba. Being a victim of sexual assault is traumatizing enough. What's the most important thing that the VA and the women's clinic can do to help them recover?
As an attorney and advocate, I think the VA does an excellent job for the women who come forth in providing health care, mental health care for those veterans. What I want to see more of is the conversion from getting access to mental health care to getting compensation for the experiences that the veterans have. So for me, that's what I'd like to see, a transition, a referral process so that those veterans can be evaluated to find out if the side effects of their military sexual trauma are compensatory, if the PTSD that they developed, the nightmares that they're having now, are something that can be compensated for. There is, of course, no amount of money that's going to make them whole from going through that experience, but there are resources, there's financial resources available for those veterans who experience military sexual trauma. So I want to see more claims filed.
Thank you, Melva, very much. I have a viewer question, Crystal from Facebook. And Dr. Sutton, I'm going to give this one to you. She writes, is the mental health services in the women's clinic separate from the behavioral mental health services offered through the main clinic? Can you take that for me?
You know, that's a great question. And I'm not sure that it is. I'm thinking now about the mental health, the women's health clinics that I have gone to, and certainly you can get referrals to all kinds of other services, including mental health services. I'm not aware, but I wouldn't be surprised by, possibility that the VA has incorporated mental health services into its women's health. It certainly hasn't been across the board. Now, I will say this as well. You know, in the last video clip, the veteran mentioned vet centers. That deserves to be underscored three times over. Over 350 vet centers, which are storefront centers where you can have a cup of coffee. Max Cleland, beloved Vietnam veteran, triple amputee. He was the youngest VA secretary. He fought like hell with his brothers and sisters from the Vietnam War to stand them up. Every one of them has a marriage and family therapist. Every one of them has mental health services and grief counselors and MST and all kinds of life-saving and relationship and trust-building measures in place. And it's also a place where, it's like a front porch. It's a place to have a cup of coffee, get your care going within the VA, including mental health care. However, let me just say this, is that the one area, in my view and in my experience, that the VA has not kept a pace, much less led the way in mental health care, is with respect to PTSD treatment. What Montel mentioned, and I will just pile on right now, is just to say that there are breakthrough treatments for PTSD, including psychedelics, which veterans and their family members are now, they are leading with their feet and with their voices. They are leading the Veterans Mental Health Coalition on Capitol Hill to get psychedelics brought forward. This is an indictment on the failure of the current treatment as usual, prolonged exposure and cognitive processing therapy treatments, which have just, as however well intended, years ago when they were brought into place as the gold standard treatments, they have not met the moment for complex military PTSD complicated by military sexual trauma.
Can I just jump on one little piece of what Lori just said? Dr. Sun just said, it is no longer time for us to take the next 10 years to go through another $100 million of investment to triple blind study. If you have a modality out there right now that we know that can bring relief to the lives of a veteran within the next 3 to 4 months, I say get it done. Stop the roadblock, because the roadblocking is just doing nothing but adding to the numbers of deaths that we see daily. We can dispute the numbers, whether they be 17 to 24 a day. You know, that the way these numbers are being calculated these days, I don't know whether or not we really have a good handle on how we're doing that, if you'll say it that way. But let's just say that if it's one more day, that's one more too many, especially if it's of those who serve for us. If there's a treatment protocol available, look, if I'm laying on the side of the road because I just got hit by a car and I got a big gash in my, you know, upper thigh, then somebody comes along and puts in a tourniquet. Don't tell me I got to wait 17 years to figure out whether or not a tourniquet really works. A tourniquet works. If it saved my life, it worked. If it saves one soldier's life, it works. So therefore, let's try to replicate that as much as we possibly can. And knock off the silly of having to have 5 or 10 or 15 years worth of studies that do the same thing over and over and over again, just slowing down the progress of getting the treatment to everybody.
Great.
Well, and it's particularly, if I could just, can I pile on over for a moment?
Of course, Dr. Sutton.
It's particularly complicated by the fact that the VA has known about this particular protocol that Montel mentioned, reconsolidation of traumatic memories, known about it for years. And when you're the major funding agency for PTSD advances in therapy, and you say this doesn't have enough research, but you're the one who grants research money, at some point it becomes not just disingenuous, it becomes unconscionable. And that's what veterans are responding to right now. And I think it's the most serious problem that is now affecting the recruitment rates. Parents, teachers, coaches, they're not telling their promising young men and women to go into the military. And it's just a unforced error. It's a tragedy that must be repaired.
So enjoying this discussion. Thank you so much. Even Montel is clapping in the background. Nobody saw that, but thank you so much to both of you. I do have another viewer question, Dr. Zinner, and maybe Dr. Mabuti could chime in on this. This is from Wendy on Facebook. What about the homeless veterans? Great question. I can't get any help because I was told I'm not homeless. However, I stand a chance of being homeless. I was told if I was on drugs, alcohol, or had a mental illness, I could get help. This is a problem! Exclamation point.
Dr. Mabuti, please.
Yeah, so definitely a big problem for our veterans is homelessness. And that is a big issue. I know that the VA is working hard to try to get it addressed. We do have our social workers, our HUDVASH counselors working, and I don't have the specifics of the program at this point, but I do understand the urgent need to address that issue because there are so many affected by this homelessness that it really is a very, very important thing that we need to address, not just as a VA, but as a nation.
Thank you. Thank you, doctor. I have a viewer question, Dr. Zinner, that I want to get to. And this one is from Linda on Facebook. It's a pretty serious question. Let me read this. What about the women vets that were affected by sexual harassment and couldn't make rank unless they went to bed with supervisor? I was in for 6 years and had to get out because I wouldn't. I got in 1984. No one would help me because I wasn't Vietnam era. I suffered from 1984 to 2022. That was when I filed a claim VFW last March, and I won. How many other women are suffering?
Oof. Wow. Dr. Sutton, let's hear from you. Mm. Wow.
Okay. What?
That's a lot.
What a story. What a trail of tears and suffering. The fact that she's telling her story now is hugely important. This issue, if you've never seen, this is years ago now, I think 2012, the film The Invisible War, you owe it to yourself to watch that film because it used DOD's own data, and it started really a 10-year sojourn for Senator Gillibrand, who just this last year, finally, one of the most important pieces lacking was the Military Justice Improvement Act, which would finally take sexual assaults out of the military commander's decision authority for deciding whether to prosecute. But this issue of individuals who are pressured from their chain of command, it's one of the reasons why PTSD in the military is so complex. First of all, you have, if you're deployed downrange, you're both the predator, prey, and witness. Typically, if you're, you know, single, you know, horrible as it is, but if you're not in a combat zone, you may, you know, these are biological terms, you're the prey, and there's a predator and perhaps a witness. In the military, this is all happening within the same brain housing group. And then you add in incest, which is that betrayal when someone in your own chain of command violates that trust. And it is just beyond, it's beyond what any of us can imagine. It's one of the reasons why women suicides 2.5 times their non-veteran counterparts in the rest of society. For those who have been assaulted, harassed, who have been abused within their units, mm-hmm. 2/3 of them talk about how they were retaliated against and how the retaliation, the mobbing, can be, in fact, often is much worse than the assault itself. So we still have so much work to do in this area, but it starts with people like this, you know, courageous veteran who spoke up tonight, sharing their story.
And Dr. Sutton, now that you mentioned, go ahead, Montel. I'm sorry.
I'm so sorry. We're not tag teaming. I just need to pile onto this. Unfortunately, if you take a look at, anybody on this panel, tell me in the last 10 years, have you seen a single movie, a single product out of Hollywood, a single story? When have you seen the last story talking about sexual assault in the military? Not seen it. It's almost as if we want to hide it, to keep it under the rug. It's time for Hollywood to start telling these stories. As embarrassing as they may be to our military, Let's embarrass the hell out of those who are perpetrators. Embarrass them to the point that we make sure that they are found out and then they are prosecuted. I go back again. What Senator Gillibrand did was amazing, getting a bill passed to make sure that now it comes out of the chain of command. It's great, but it still hasn't reverberated enough yet. We need to have a society that says, if we're going to force the least of us to protect the most of us, then damn it, protect the least of us.
Thank you so much, Montel. And Dr. Sutton, you mentioned suicide, and I'm actually glad you brought up this topic, because suicide deaths among veterans is another major issue that the VA is combating, which is very, very sad. Take a look at this graphic right here. But there is good news about the rate of suicide deaths. There is also some disturbing news about the use of firearms, especially by women veterans. Suicide deaths overall have decreased slightly for women veterans. It was just under 14%, which you can see right there in 2020. But when looking at the number of women vets who used a firearm, there was a jump of nearly 49% from 2001 to 2020. And that increase is troubling, Dr. Zinner.
Dr. Mabuti, and how is the VA working to identify those women veterans that are at risk?
So suicide prevention is a top priority at the VA. And we do realize and recognize that some veterans may not reach out to mental health providers regarding this issue. So in the VA, we are taking a proactive public health stand in the premise that suicide prevention is everyone's business. So all the services, our women's health providers, we are all trained and equipped to screen for suicide ideations, chronic post-traumatic stress disorder, sexual trauma. We incorporate all those screenings into our primary care visits so we are able to have that conversation with our veteran in a comfortable environment. And we do have a behavioral health integration within our primary care clinics. And so during the actual visit, we can actually have a same-day appointment with a behavioral therapist at that moment in time so that we can address the veteran's health mental health concerns and come up with a plan at that point.
Dr. Sutton, beside the fact that veterans on the whole are more familiar with firearms and more women have been on or near the front lines in Iraq and Afghanistan, and the lengths of deployments are longer, can those factors play a role in suicide or attempted suicides, and what can we do about those?
Well, it's a complex issue. Part of what our research is showing shows that actually individuals who were never deployed suffer from a higher rate of completed suicides than those who were deployed. Now you can, it would take a while to unpack that. And I think there are a lot of leadership issues involved on the home front that make those unit environments hellish, to include military sexual trauma, to include a whole host of factors. But this issue of suicide prevention that's been talked about, it's a wonderful public health approach. It's a sea change for the VA to take this step. But I will say this, it's necessary, but it is completely insufficient to launch a national high priority suicide prevention campaign, as the VA has done. But to get stuck in the rut with the same failed PTSD treatments that now the VA's own researchers and clinicians and veterans, as I mentioned before, and their family members are voting with their feet and with their voices. I love the care that I get, the health care that I get at the VA. And as I talk with primary care docs and folks in the waiting room, fellow veterans, folks across the VA health landscape, one recurring comment is, I love my health care here, but boy, I got PTSD. I wouldn't go near psychotherapy within the VA. That's got to fix. That's got to be fixed right now. And that will help bring those suicides back down, which never should be at the levels they are and which have sustained themselves now for years.
Thank you so much.
For Dr. Zimmer, I'm so sorry. Here I go again. But
don't worry.
One of the things that I remember when I came up back to duty, the one thing we do well, yes, we train our soldiers well. We train us to use guns. When I left the military, by the time I had been out of the military for almost 17 years, I had 14 guns. What do I need 14 guns for? I had 14 guns. And one of those guns had me sitting in a closet one time when I finally, when I got diagnosed with MS, thinking about and contemplating taking my own life. And we are going to have to, I respect the Second Amendment. I respect that, no question. But why can't we take a minute to tell the discharging veteran, you know what, it's been great. I know you love your weapon, man, but you know, you won't have to take that in the civilian world. You don't. There's other things that you can do. You can go hunting, yeah, that's one thing, but do you really have to go out and buy, you know, the fifth, 6 hour? Do you really have to go and buy the third 9mm? No, you don't need to.
Thank you. No, it's okay. We're actually running out of time, and I'm so loving this. We've got only about a minute left, and my apologies, Montel, for interrupting, but it's been unbelievable, right, Dr. Zinner?
Montel and all the members, great information. Thank you to our panels for helping us understand the benefits the VA offers women and some of the specific problems women veterans face.
That's right. We also want to thank our viewers for tuning in and sending in your questions. Again, the panel was fantastic. And by the way, in case you missed the number and you have questions about women's health services or resources at the VA, you can reach out to the Women's Veterans Call Center. There is the number, 855-829-6636. And of course, open Monday through Friday and Saturdays as well. 855-829-6636. What an amazing hour we've had, huh, Dr. Zinner?
Olga, I have to tell you, even listening tonight as a veteran, I can't tell you how important it is to get this information out to those who served our country.
Thank you.
Olga,
thank
you. And the panelists, thank you.
That's right. And so on behalf of Dr. Zinner and myself, we wish you a wonderful day. Take care.
Stay strong.
Thank you to the Eunice Joyce Gardner Charitable Foundation for its leadership support of the Health Channel.